Hello everyone, this is Calvin Castine. It's a frosty November afternoon, and Hometown Cable, as you know, always trying to find new and different things to bring you. And today we're going to bring you a sport that we've never brought you before. And the dozens and dozens of sports we've given you over the years, you might think we've run out of them, but thanks to Norbert Yakey, we found a new sport, and it's only 4 miles north of the U.S. border. We're in LaColle, and Sam Castine on the camera is probably zooming in right now on Club de Curling LaColle. So we're going to go inside and find out a little bit more about one of Canada's favorite sports, a sport that's never quite caught on in the U.S. side of North America, curling. So stick with us and we'll learn as I learn. Okay, we have come inside and we're nice and warm here. We have a nice view of what's happening down below. And we have someone here who's going to tell us everything we need to know about this sport. Your name, sir?
I'm Don Robinson. I've been in curling for about 35 years right now. Curling is a sport that started in Scotland. We're looking at one of the oldest sports in the world. It started about 1500 in Scotland with stones, just flat stones that they found in the fields, and they started curling, throwing them up and down ice. Now, the stones we have today are all stones that come from Scotland, because the only granite in the world that's hard enough to take the banging that the stones have is the Scottish blue granite. As you see, there's a stone going down there, and the idea of curling is the curling sheet is 144 feet long. And the idea is to throw it from this end down to the house down at the far end, the blue and the red circles. It's very similar scoring as shuffleboard.
That's what I was thinking. Now you see the people with the broom. We're going to get into this a bit more about your background and everything else. Don, is it?
Yeah.
Don. But the first question that comes to my mind is, has always been, what the heck are those people doing with the brooms?
Well, it looks awful silly. It's not people trying to run up and down the ice with their butts up in the air. But the idea of the broom is that if you put enough friction on your brush in front of the stone, you are going to actually melt a very, very thin layer of ice, and that your stone will maintain its momentum longer. So two people brushing a stone can actually take a stone between 12 and 15 feet further than if you didn't brush the ice at all. Now the whole idea is that you're putting enough friction on the ice that you're melting a very, very thin layer.
Now maybe later on we'll go down and we can take a look at the bristles. Is there bristles on those little brooms?
Well, there's bristles or there's material. Most of the brushes are coming today with material. So because a bristle, if you lose a bristle from your brush, the stone will stop immediately. It's very, very deadly to a stone if you happen to have an old broom and you lose a bristle. Now, the scoring is roughly the same as in shuffleboard. The closest one to the center is the stone that counts, and as soon as there's another stone of an opposite color, the rest don't count. So if you have one red right in the center and then four blue around the outside, it's still only the one red that counts the point.
Okay, I'm going to keep interrupting you here, and first thing I want to do is find out a little bit more about Donald Robinson. Now, that's an English-sounding name. Are you from an English area of Canada?
Well, I live in LaColle. We've been here since 1799, I believe, is when the ancestors arrived here. But we're celebrating our 50th year of curling here in LaColle this year. This is the 50th year.
Has this building been here for 50 years?
The land has been here for 50 years. We originally used an old army barracks 50 years ago and moved it down here. And then 10 years ago we built this building, and about 5 years ago we built the clubhouse that you saw outside. We increased the size. The stones, they weigh 45 pounds. Actually, I'll have to show you afterwards how the stone, the ice surface has to have a pebble put on it. We'll see the man going out here afterwards, and he puts like a fine spray on top of the ice. And the stone actually rides on top of those little bumps on the ice. If you look carefully down there, you can see that the ice is not smooth. It's got little bubbles on it. Because if the ice is completely smooth, you cannot throw a stone down because there's just too much friction.
Okay, now, do people own their own stones, or does the club provide stones here? If you compare with bowling, the bowling alley has balls, you can bring your own?
Originally, when curling started, you owned your own stones, but they were iron stones. But now they've developed into the granite stones, and the club owns their own stones, and nobody owns stones as per se.
Now, how many different colors do you have of handles on the stones? Just red and blue, is that basically it?
Yes. Curling is a team sport with four people throwing two stones each, so that there are four people on the team, and they each take turns throwing two stones. The men at the far end holding the broom are what we call the skips, or the captains of the team, and they throw the last stones. They will put their brush down on the ice and ask you to aim for their brush, and they'll either ask for an in-turn or an out-turn. On your in-turn, it will curl to your right going down, and on the out-turn, it'll curl to your left.
So they have to ask for this before they throw it?
If you see the skips down there right now, he's got one hand up in the air, and so that he's asking for this player here to throw an in-turn, and he wants the stone to leave the center line and go over behind those ones on the front of the house to draw in behind them, so he's protected.
Okay, what is he trying to do here? Is he trying to hit that front stone, move it more toward the center?
He's trying to draw in behind it. Like, that front stone is the opposition stone. It's red. He's trying to get closer to the button than that red stone. You see how he's coming over there now? They're working it hard to try and bring it into, like, that's a beautiful shot. That's a beautiful shot.
Okay, so that what I was looking at was that stone that's right in front of the circle in our direction. They're trying to avoid that one instead of tapping it?
It is always easier to try to draw in behind the stone than it is to raise the stone back into the house. If you do not hit the stone absolutely straight, it's going to go and be into the open where a person can take it out.
Okay, so now there's a total of eight stones that are
There's a total rowed. Of eight stones. Whoever takes a point in the last end throws the first stone, so that the advantage of throwing last stone alternates whether you took the point the previous end.
How many points could you maximize on an eight throw?
Eight stones. You can only get 1 point per stone, which is if you score all eight, it is a lot more rare than a hole in one in golf. It only happens like in Canada, we have roughly 500,000 curlers. And a perfect end, which is eight stones, only happens like 10 to 20 times a year in all the games across Canada. So it's much rarer than a hole in one in golf.
Okay, now, I'm sure you mentioned this already. Now, do you get points anywhere within the wide circle too? Is that what you said?
Yeah. They have to touch the circles. In curling, we call this a house, and it has to touch the house somewhere. So the blue or the white or the red circle.
So whoever is closest to the center determines
who gets
the points. And the other person could have seven stones within there, and the other person can only have one. But if you got the closest one, you get the 1 point.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And that's the advantage of having the last stone, so that the skip or the captain of the team is supposed to be able to put his stone in the 2 foot every time he throws it. But that's not all. You see, he's coming down and he's going to remove that stone that they just put in there, you see? You see it rolled right into the center, so that red one now is definitely shot.
Now, if somebody's, your opponent's ball, stone is slowly making its way to the outside of that ring, can you go over there with your broom and help it out?
Okay, you cannot You cannot sweep an opposition stone until it crosses the center line in the house, which is called the T line. Like, if your opponents are throwing from that end down here, you cannot start brushing the ice until it clears the T line.
That's in the center of the bullseye?
That's in the center of the bullseye. Once it clears that, well, then anybody can sweep it. One player per team can sweep it.
So when you see two people sweeping it, that means the both sides want to sweep it for some reason? I think I saw that happen.
It could happen that both sides want it back as far, like, there's advantages of getting the stone so it's on the back of the house. If you have one in the front of the house just biting the blue, you don't want your stone to stop so that all they have to do is come and touch it. Because then if they just touch it, you're automatically shot. So sometimes it's a harder shot if you sweep your stone back so that if he comes to it, he's not shot. You see? So sometimes both skips will be sweeping the same stone.
Okay, we're going to take a break, give Sam's arm a rest, and we'll come right back with more of curling in LaColle. Okay, we are back with Don Robinson. Are you related to the Robinsons on the southern side of the border?
Yeah. Lynn and Tom were cousins.
Okay. Tom, of course, ran Sunny Hill Dairy for so many years, and Leon lives right next to Northeastern Clinton Central.
Yeah.
And that's only 5-6 miles from here. So
that's roughly 5 miles from here, 6 miles, yeah.
Okay, let's get back to a little bit, Don, if we could. Speaking of Don, there's one of Leon's sons is named Don also, right?
Yeah, that's right.
One of the twins.
Yeah.
Let's get back to the history of this place here. Is this a club? Do you join this like a golf club, or is this privately run, or what's the story on the...
Okay. Pretty near all the curling clubs in this part of the country are all club, the same as a golf club. You pay your membership, you are a member of the curling club, and you do a lot of work for the curling club. Like today we have these outside teams and all the ladies are cooking for the meal, and so it's the same as a golf club. We have elect a president every year and executive, and they run the club, and then we have elections every year, and it's usually a 2-year term for the golf clubs, or curling clubs, excuse me.
Okay, where's your nearest curling club to here?
Okay, in this district, which is called the Southwest District of Quebec, our nearest one is Bedford, which is 25 miles east of us. And going up to the west, we're looking at Howick, Riverfield, Ormsdown, Beauharnois, Valleyfield. That's the 8 clubs in our district. So when we have a competition, those are the teams that we play against, the clubs we play against mostly.
Sounds like you're part of a national organization.
Yes, we are. Curling, the Royal Caledonia Curling Club is the oldest curling association there is in North America. It was formed in 1852. And where parent club is the Royal Caledonia Scottish Club in Scotland. But the Canadian Curling Association is 1852, which is the oldest sports federation in North America. Every club elects somebody to go to the, it's same as golf actually, you know, your Royal Golf Association. Every club has a representative on the Canadian branch. And from the Canadian branch, we go up to the Canadian Curling Association, which is all across Canada, and we have one representative per province. So it's either male or female, so that means we have 10 provinces and 2 territories that form the Canadian Curling Association that governs curling for Canada. In the United States, it's your Grand National Curling Association. And they all make up part of the World Curling Federation now, and curling is going to be an Olympic sport, official Olympic sport in 98 in Nagasaki, Japan this year. We've been demonstrator sport for the last 2 Olympics, but this year we're an official sport, and everybody's expecting Canada and the United States to do very well.
How many countries actively pursue the sport? Any idea?
We have in the Olympics, we had to have 18 curling associations from 18 countries to be eligible. And as of right now, we have 20. But the major curling powers are Canada, United States, Scotland, Finland, Sweden, Germany. These are your major curling powers.
Where's the nearest curling facility in the States? Is there any nearby? I'm not familiar with any. In fact, I wasn't even familiar with this place here, which is right in our backyard.
Lake Placid has a curling club. They curl in one of the skating arenas every Saturday, Saturday and Sunday afternoon. There's a curling club in Lake Placid. And then we go to Albany and Schenectady. Both have very active clubs.
Okay, now, is this a year-round sport? Do you bother making ice in the summer? Or what time does your season start?
Our season starts when the golf season closes. This is curling and golf seem to go hand in hand. So curling usually starts in this club. We're a little bit earlier than other country clubs, but we usually start the second week of October and we go through to the second week in April. Cape Cod has a curling club that runs 12 months a year down there, and they're very well insulated. They can run the 12 months. We have trouble in this club, but we're not quite well insulated enough so that we get a fog coming off the ice in the summertime when it gets up to 55, 60 degrees outside.
Well, you don't bother trying to keep the ice year-round, do you?
No, we don't keep the ice after the 10th of April. It's usually when we close down.
Now, how thick is the ice? It doesn't look like it's very thick out there.
The ice varies between different clubs. Like, you have to have a level surface. On this sheet on our right-hand side, we didn't get it quite level. On the far end, we probably have 2 inches of ice, and at this end, we probably have only about an inch.
Curling uphill or downhill?
No, we're not curling. Once you get, the water will go to its own level. But we have to have 2 inches of ice down there before we're level at this end.
I see.
So water finds it its own level. And when we flood, we put on enough water that water is all over the ice from end to end.
Now, I see those holes in the boards. Is it wood? That the wood surface that they make the ice on top of? Is that what it is? It looks like holes out there, like an air hockey table.
Okay. This is our surface here. We have the insulation underneath, then our pipes. And the holes that you are seeing, we put white plastic down on top of the sand, on top of our pipes. And those holes are to let the coolness from the pipes come up through the ice. And this is, the little holes down there are just to let the coldness come up through from the pipes underneath. And it's white plastic, so we don't have to paint our ice. The blue and the red are blue and red plastics that make the house.
Okay, what's the significance of those little circles that say 50 in the middle of them?
It's our 50th anniversary this year, so that's it's not for the beer we have up here, but it's for our 50th anniversary this year.
It's not for Labatt's Blue, right?
It's not for Labatt's Blue.
Okay, so would those circles normally be there, or is it just decorative?
That's just decorative for this year. Let everybody know that we're celebrating our 50th anniversary. Near the ceiling, you can see, and those are two little electric heaters we have. We like to keep the temperature out there roughly 27, 28 degrees so that it's not that cold out there for people to curl. The heaters we try and keep the temperature 27, 28. So the ice temperature to curl has to be kept at 22 to 23 degrees. If you get ice temperature of 25 degrees, it slows down the curling a lot. This ice today, from the time the man releases it until it stops here, we're looking at 26 second ice. If it goes to 25 degrees, all of a sudden it's only taking 10 seconds. Or 15 seconds, say.
So just a few degrees makes a big difference in the speed.
It's unbelievable. And the other thing that we have is humidity. We have to try and keep the humidity not too high, or else then again it slows down the ice, the time it takes to throw the stone. Like a 25, 26 second time to, it's just a nice easy delivery, nice easy slide the man's coming out with. But if you're looking at 15 to 17, you have to throw it much faster. Like this man is throwing enough weight to try and take the stone out. It's a takeout.
Now, can you change the direction of the stone by only one sweeper sweeping?
No, you cannot change the direction, but you can keep the stone. The idea of sweeping a heavy stone like a takeout is to keep the stone straight. Once it slows down, then's when it starts to curl a lot more. So the idea of sweeping a fast-running stone is to try and keep it straight.
Okay, you just mentioned the word curl, and this is called curling. So what is the significance of curl in the curling sport?
Okay, as you watch any stone coming up, they always tend to go to one side or the other with the way the handle is turned, and we call that the way the stone is curling in or out. You see, it's impossible to go out there and throw a stone with no handle straight down the ice. The stone, you can try, but it's going to pick up a little bit of debris on the ice and start turning one way or the other. So when you put the turn on the stone, that is the way you want it to curl or to climb. Another word would be climb.
But it's not climbing, it's curling, so we're going to use the word curling.
Yeah.
Now, I assume you want to release it, though, with as little spin on that handle as possible.
That is right. When you're releasing, you want, ideally, the stone should only turn about five times coming up the 140 feet of ice. Because if you turn your stone and it starts coming up, and your that's a twirler, they call it. If it starts rotating like 15 times, instead of curling, your stone will go absolutely straight. So this is another part of curling.
We got a big traffic jam coming up here. There's going to be a big collision.
Well, not much. It's still only one blue stone counting with all those stones in the house. You see, okay. The red one is knocking out the other blue ones.
Yeah. Okay, well, Sam has given me the signal that our battery is
getting lower.
It needs to be changed, so we're going to take a moment right in the middle of the action here to switch our battery.
Scoring.
We're going to get into the scoring, and before I forget, I want to mention that the reason we're here is because a man from Champlain who married a girl from Clarenceville, Norbert Yakey, invited us down here today for this tournament. He thought we'd find it interesting. And you're just saying that we're nearing the end of the game here, and I can't tell what the heck the score is. What's the score? Was it 7-5 here on the left?
On the left, okay. The score
on
our left, the score here right now is 6-5. The score is in the middle, in the red numbers. The black numbers are the ends that you played, okay?
Okay.
So Howick took one in the first end, and then Lavalster Lalac took two in the second end. And then you come back down to the third end. Howick took two blue stones, so the score was, after three ends, the score was 3-2. And then Howick took the fourth and fifth end. They stole it because they didn't have last shot, which means they steal the end.
I knew that.
They stole the fourth end and the fifth end. So after five ends, the score was 5-3. And then Laval-sur-Lalac in the seventh end took a three to go up 6-5. And they're coming home right now. And the blue stone is the one that is closest to the center. And this is the skip, or the captain's first shot. And he's going to try and remove that.
Well, isn't this the eighth end?
This is the eighth
end. So I see that seven up there, so it's 6-5, like you say. They took three points in the seventh.
Yeah, to go ahead.
One in the third. One in the sixth for the...
Yeah. One in the second, one in the sixth, and one in the seventh.
Now I see... Now you were telling us off camera that there are eight... What do you call them? Ends?
Eight ends in a game.
Like, this would be like innings in baseball, or frames, 10 frames in bowling.
And each in takes roughly 15 minutes to play, so we're looking at a game. It's going to take 2 hours for an 8-in game. This is what we curl.
So you pack a lunch when you come for a tournament?
Yes.
Or in this case, you buy it here.
Well, when we go to a curling bonspiel, curling tournament, whatever you want to call it, that is all included in your entry fee. Like the entry fee here today for a team was $40. That includes their lunch. The winners will come back on Wednesday, and they'll get prizes plus door prizes and things like this.
Is the winner going to be determined today?
No, the winner will be determined Wednesday.
So like you'll have the top?
We have 8 teams in today, which will play.
Eliminate 4 of them, probably?
We'll eliminate all 6. The 2 with the highest percentage will come back on Wednesday. And on tomorrow, the 2 with the highest percentage, and they'll come back on Wednesday too. So that we'll have 4 teams on Wednesday that'll play off 2 games, winner against winner and loser against loser. And so that's how we determine our winner on Wednesday.
Okay, so it's kind of like a consolation game and a championship game on Wednesday.
Yeah. Well, it'll be 2 games. In the morning, right, the 4 winners will play off. And then in the afternoon, it'll be winner against winner, loser against losers.
All right, Sam's really getting into this. He's following every stone down there, so I may have trouble dragging him out of here.
This stone over here, he's trying to hit the blue onto the red, and he's done it. I don't know what happened over here now. He moved everything around, but the blue stone is still the closest to the center.
It looks like it'd be very hard to get to that blue stone, too. It's well protected.
What he'll have to try and do is hit the one in front of it back, and so his strategy right now is that he was going to try and put a guard in front so that the man will not be able to come down and raise a blue onto the blue and out, which would leave his red sitting shot.
Yeah, well, right now we are in the eighth.
There's 3 more stones to come.
That's right.
There's only 3 more stones to come. He's going to ask for they call it a guard, to protect the skip from the next shot.
Okay, now I see 3 stones for blue definitely inside the circle. Is that fourth one? Is that fourth one in there too? Looks like it's just barely touching.
Well, as long as it touches, that's a point.
Now, I don't see any referees out here. What happens if they can't agree?
We have a measuring stick. It's hanging up on the wall over there. There's a hole right in the very center of the button, and you use that to determine which stone is the closest.
And well, then I'm talking about it, whether it's on the.
The other stick over there is a 6-foot stick. You put the pin in the button and you turn it around to see if it touches that blue stone.
I see.
And that stick up there, the 6-foot stick, will determine whether it's in or out.
So if there is any discrepancy, any argument, that's how they're settled. But most times, I imagine they agree.
Curling arguments, it's a gentleman's sport.
And ladies. However, coming on here.
There are, in club games, there are no referees or anything like this, but you get into provincial championships leading to Olympics, then you have referees on the ice. He went to put his guard, and it curled too much for him, and he left that shot open. So if he hits the blue, back onto the blue, his red would be sitting shot.
Now, there's nothing like in this that says you have to hit it. To our right here, something they just goofed up here. Yeah, so they're very upset. What happened over to our right here?
I missed that. I was always...
Okay, well, looks like the game is over here to our right, and looks like blue won. They're in the center, and they were leading...
They were leading, too, so...
9-7, so they're, it's now 10-7, it looks like.
Yeah, the game was finished up at 10-7, and they will get points, like... 5 points for the win, plus 2 points for each end that they took. Like they took 5 ends, the 8th is not marked up. So they'd get 5 for the win, 2 points each end is 10, so that's 15, plus half the difference of the score, which is 1.5, so they'll end up with 16.5.
Oh, wait a minute here. Wait a minute here. Okay, you get 5 points for winning.
2 points for each end that you took.
Okay, so then they took 5 ends because they took the 1st, 2nd, 4th, 7th, and 8th.
That's right.
So they get 2 points, that's 15.
That's 15 plus half the difference of the score. The score is 10-7, 3 points, half the difference is 1.5. So they will get 16.5 points.
And what are they going to do with those points?
They will combine them with their points that they get this afternoon. And if they have the highest, or one of the first or second highest placed teams today, will they come back on Wednesday to go in?
Now, only the winning team in the game gets the points, so the other team doesn't get the 6 points for their ends?
Oh, yeah. They get their 6 points. And if they go out and win the next game like 14 to nothing, they still have a chance of coming back on Saturday.
But it doesn't.
Or Thursday, I'm sorry.
Well,
it's Wednesday.
Okay. Now, it's possible that you could get 7 ends and still lose, right?
It is.
Does that happen very often?
Not 7, but quite frequently you can take 6 ends and lose a game. If you take 1 point an end, that's 6 points. If the other team takes a 4 and a 5, they take 2 ends and they beat you.
Okay, good. But for the 7 ends, the other teams have to be perfect, and they say that happens very, very rarely.
An 8-ender. Yeah. 8-ender is very rare. Yeah. An 8-ender has happened here in LaColle Curling Club only once in the 50 years.
And you were there when it happened?
I missed it. There was a fellow from Howick, Norman LeDuc from Howick, that scored the 8-ender here in LaColle.
Okay, is he here today? I see Howick just finished.
This shot, he decided that his best bet was to try and hit the 2 foot on this outturn draw. So now he's going to have to stop it in the white to beat that other blue one out. So everybody's out there sweeping, but I don't know whether it's going to be long enough or not.
Looks like it's going to be short to me.
Well, it's going to be doggone tight. I would say he's short by about 2 inches.
What happens here? These people are concentrating on sweeping, and they're watching that stone coming down. It's very possible you could accidentally kick a stone. What happens?
If you hit a stone, your own stone, in motion, the stone is dead. You take it out of play.
But one of the dead ones that are sitting there.
If you hit a stationary stone, the opponents replace it where they think it was. Okay,
so
this is the rules of curling.
So you don't want to hit a stone?
You don't want to hit a stone.
Because I'm sure that stone was right dead center when they hit it.
So anyway.
Okay, now this guy here, is he just going to play?
This man is going to try, and he's taking less ice. He's going to try and draw in, because the game is tied right now. Now, if he draws in better than that red one, he'd have 2, you see? And win the game.
How do you figure it's tied?
Right now.
They were down by 1.
But the blue has got 1 counting here right now.
I thought they had 4 counting.
No, because the red one is closer. The red is second shot.
So you have to, only the stones that are closer than the opponent's stones count?
Yeah. Now he is too heavy. What's he going to do?
If he hits that red one onto the...
So right now the game, it ends up tied. The blue stone is the closest. The 2 red ones are canceled out, and all the blues right around the edge are all canceled out.
Okay.
So
it's only the ones that you have that are closer than your opponent's.
That's right. The same as shuffleboard scoring or anything like that.
You're assuming I know shuffleboard scoring.
Oh, anybody's supposed to know that.
I used to. It's been a long time, though. I used to. Did you ever go to the Holland Hotel in Rouse's Point and play shuffleboard?
Yeah, that's a good many years ago, eh?
All right, we just finished now. Howick just finished now. Is Howick that person who...
Howick?
Who did that great feat? Is he here?
No, he's not here. No.
Now, I see some people had the Scottish hats on. Is that a team uniform-like?
Yeah, a lot of teams curl in this uniform. Curling originated in Scotland, and anybody with any Scottish ancestry likes to brag of the fact that they're Scottish and they supposedly good curlers.
Now, is Robinson English, or what is that?
Robinson's a mixture of everything. We've got a little bit of English, a lot of English, and it's a little bit of Scotch.
Yeah. All right. Let me ask you this. Your ice looks like it's got very little moisture, if any moisture, on it. Yet you're telling me every time they come down with that broom, they're melting the ice. Do you end up with ridges out there at all?
No. With your broom, your brush, you're actually melting like a micrometer, a micro millimeter, you know, mm-hmm. it's just to get the surface damp. And slippery, damp ice is slipperier than dry ice. Now, this is what we do in between games. Like, he's passing this big brush over here to pick up any debris that was left from shoes or anything that fell off your sweater, like a wool off your sweater. Any of this will affect the stone running down the ice. So he's going to pass the big broom over everything.
Now Sam thinks that's a walking Zamboni out there. Is that what it?
Well, now this is the interesting part of curling. You're going to see him come up here with this blue can and put a fine, fine mist on the ice. And this is going to be the running surface for the new game. Now.
Now, okay, while he's doing that, this is a tournament. Looks like he's...
He's just spreading a very fine mist on the ice. The holes in his pebbling can are just like the size of pinheads. And this is the art of good ice, is how you get this pebble on with the... it has to be consistent and it has to cover the whole ice surface. If you look down, you can just see it going on.
Just little droplets.
Yeah. Now he'll have to get these guys off this sheet of ice so he can pebble this. Now,
I don't think they swept this side, have they?
Yeah, I think he did it while we weren't looking.
Okay, now these shoes.
Okay.
Sam was asking off camera about shoes. Are they broom ball type of shoes, or what kind of shoes do they have here?
Well, most of them buy what are real curling shoes. Curling shoe is one sole, has got a gripper on it that's very soft rubber so that you can stand up and you have some grip on your ice. When you deliver the stone, your sliding foot, as they call it, usually has Teflon on it. This is just so that you can slide out and with your stone. When curling started, nobody ever slid. They just stood in the hack and threw the stone. But you see this lady coming out with that sliding foot, it just slides and you can come out behind your stone. The professional players deliver right at the hog line, that big blue line 22 feet up from the front of the house.
You go that far out?
They go out that far out.
Are you allowed to do that here?
Oh yeah, you're allowed. All the kids, the junior curlers, they slide, but they have to clear, their stone has to be clear of their hand when you hit that hog line.
Otherwise you lose the throw.
Yeah. This is where referees come into the national sports, so that make sure that nobody goes across the hog line with the stone in their hand.
Yeah, the man on the, yeah. These people are just sliding just to get the feel of the ice?
Yeah, that's just to loosen up, get the muscles. Like they played this morning, this is their second game, so when you play the second game a day, you're getting a little bit stiff. Curling is I find it very hard to believe, but curling is one of the most strenuous sports that there is. We go through a lot of training. I work with the juniors a lot. We take a lot of courses in curling. But curling is, which is impossible to believe, but it ranks about fifth in the amount of calories that you're burning in a game. You take a lot of sports. You take a game of football, for example. You're actually only playing for, what, 12 minutes a game you're moving? The rest of the time it's you're counting for your snap back to your quarterback, or you're just standing there. Here, curling, the sheet of ice is 150 to 40 feet long, 444, and you're sliding, walking back and forth every time. They throw a stone. So curling is ranks about number six as far as energy burnt. It's actually, you burn more energy here than in a hockey game with three full lines. It sounds like today we have the seniors here, curling. But curling is a sport where we start with the kitty rocks, weigh 17 pounds, and we like to start the kids when they're 6-7 years old. And we have Mr. Wolf Marchand that's holding the broom up there right now. He is into his 84th year, I believe, and he's still going very strong.
Which one is he?
He's
color jacket.
He's got the white jacket, the white and black jacket, the multicolored up there.
And he's on the right?
He's on the right.
With a red hat?
Yeah, that's Wolf Marchand. And he's in his 84th year. We have older curlers than that in the club, but they're not here yet.
Okay, now this is a tournament. I think, I don't know if you've told us on camera or not, but there are 8 clubs represented here?
There are 8 clubs represented today. Right now, we have Royal Montreal, which is the oldest curling, well, the oldest sports club in North America. They were formed as the Montreal Club, and they were organized in the 1802. And they are now called, they added Royal to the Montreal Curling Club in 1850. And we have St. Lambert, they're curling against St. Lambert. And then we have St. Anne de Bellevue and Bay Durfee on the West Island of Montreal out here right now.
And the other four?
The other four were from Howick, Laval. I forget who the other two were.
But do you have one local? Is there a local team?
Your idea of the Bonspiel, your tournament, is if you can get all filled with all outside teams, it's best so that you have no chance of winning your own tournament.
Or even playing in it.
So
what's the fun of having a tournament if you can't compete?
That's when we go back to their place. Like this is, we'll be going, teams from LaColle will be going to each one of these 16 clubs that are represented during the winter.
Now, how do you choose who's on your team?
Well, in LaColle here, this is senior Bonspiels. You have to be 55 and over to curl on them. We have 32 members that are over 55. We have a list downstairs, and everybody sends out a flyer when their tournament is, and whoever is available can go. There's no problem.
So you can send more than, what is it?
We can
4 people on a team, you said?
4 people on a team.
But you could have 4 in one game and 4 in another game?
Yeah. Like these guys curl, like how it works. They usually start at 10 o'clock with whatever number of teams it is. Like if you have 3 sheets, it's 6 teams. And then there's another 6 at the bottom that curl at 1 o'clock. So you're never curling against yourselves unless you get to the finals.
Okay, well, what you're saying then is you'd have 2 teams in there, and that wouldn't be one team, 2 teams representing your club. It'd be 2 teams each representing the club, so you would have more than 1 team.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I see men and women. You could have all women, all men, 3 men, 1 woman, or whatever?
Just about any combination today. There are a lot of open Bonspiels now. It used to be men, ladies, and mixed. But today we're going to more open Bonspiels, and that is a combination of 3 men and 1 lady, or 3 ladies and 1 man, whatever they want, as long as they are. Some of the ladies are very strong curlers. Maybe they lack a little bit on the brushing or broom ability.
Well, they need to practice at home more, I think.
That's for sure. Different day and age.
Years ago, the ladies were very handy with that broom. They've gotten away from that over the years, Don.
Yeah, that's for sure. Now the men are doing more than ladies, I guess, eh?
Now, what's your address here in case people wanted, ladies want to dispute that? J-O-1...
No, that's a postal code. Send them up to the curling club here and we'll discuss it with them. just before you guys got here, I was in the dishpan, so my hands are clean. It's a case of where it's a club, and everybody pitches in and does their share.
That's now, what's a young guy like you doing here on a weekday like this?
Well, I'm...
Are you retired?
No. I'm a dairy farmer.
Oh, and farmers have all the time in the world.
That's for sure. And anyway, I was supposed to be here at 9 o'clock this morning to welcome everybody here, and I didn't make it, so some of the seniors are a little bit disgusted with me for not getting up in the morning.
And what time did you get up?
5:45.
5:45, so that's not bad. No. I always thought farmers had to be up by 5.
Well, some farmers, I guess.
All right, you've offered to take us down below to ice level. Anything else we need to cover while we're up here?
I don't think so, but as I said, it's a sport that everybody does. It's a family sport. We start with 7, 8 years old right up to the senior citizens of 80. Our oldest member is Tom Kern, and I believe he's 87 right now.
So. There are a few people from the States here. I saw Arthur Vanderbeek down there, Bob Manigold, and of course Norbert Yankee invited us over here. You're getting more from the States coming over?
We'd sure love to have a lot more from the States because we're only 5 miles, but it's a sport that has been very hard to get Americans involved in unless you're in the Midwest or in you're down in the Boston, Cape Cod area. That's where curling is very popular in the States.
Well, what happens if somebody was interested in coming up here and finding out more about the sport? If you want to find out about bowling, you could go to the bowling alley and throw a few balls and rent a lane for a while. What can they do here to get into it?
Well, curling is, we try to advertise that we have like an open house certain times a year where anybody's welcome to come and try it. And we have one tournament where we put one member plus three completely new people out in the spring of the year to try to introduce more people to it. And this one Bonspiel tournament is the one where I'd like to get you guys into it.
When is that?
That's usually in March. Second and third week of March is when we usually have it. But if there's ever any group that would be available, there's a lot of us that would love to come and introduce you to curling. The ice is available anytime during the daytimes, a senior curls Tuesday. But on the weekends, the ice is available for groups on Saturday and Sunday.
That's when I would think that would be least available, be on the weekends, but it's available during the day, you're saying? Or?
During the day. In this, the juniors have it Saturday and Sunday morning, but in the afternoons, the ice is usually available unless there's a weekend tournament going on or something. Here in LaColle, the club is going every night of the week except for Saturday and Sunday nights. It's hard to get people out on the weekends here right now for some reason.
So you have leagues here at the club? Is that what you have?
Yeah. We have leagues that start, well, this year we start at the 20th of October. And the leagues stay together until February, and then we start playing down to winners.
Now, how about safety? You're talking 84-year-old people out here, 87-year-old people out here. You have to be a little concerned about somebody falling and hitting themselves in the head on the ice out here. Does that happen very often?
It's as long as you have a good, soft, rubber-sole shoe, doesn't happen that often. But you do have some falls. Touch wood, we've never had any serious injury in curling in this area that I have heard of. We've had some people fall and bang their head, and we've taken them to the hospital, but no serious injury.
Is that rare, though, that somebody falls?
It's rare. You're on ice, and you're cautious. You just don't go barging around. You try and, as long as you have a good gripper on your shoe, that you're not going to lose slide. That's the thing.
Can you rent shoes here like a bowling alley, or you have to own shoes before you come?
No, you have to. We have what they call slip-ons. They have just a piece of Teflon that you slip on your shoe and you can try curling like that. But it's recommended that you take a pair of running shoes or something and modify it and use them. The main thing is that we have to have very clean footwear. We can't allow people to go out with shoes that they've worn coming into the building, because if there's any sand or a little piece of gravel or something go out on our ice, it just ruins the... You shoot a stone and all of a sudden your stone will stop. And this is just because of a little piece of gravel or grit from the sidewalk or something like this. So we have to have clean footwear. That's the number one rule of all curling, I'd say.
Okay, now if somebody did come here on a Saturday afternoon or Sunday afternoon, it's easy to find. You just come through the border on the U.S. side on Route 276. What's the route on this side? 202?
221.
221. And
you come to the first railroad track in LaColle and turn right and you're on Curling Street. And we're down three buildings.
So you can't miss it.
But I would advise, well, I'm sure Norm Yaki would give you his telephone numbers in Champlain, or if anybody phones me or anybody at the club, we'd be more than willing to come and spend an afternoon here and try to introduce you to the game of curling.
Now, is there usually somebody here minding the building on a Saturday afternoon and Sunday afternoon?
No, not unless there's arrangements have been made.
So you can't just pop in and say, I want to try it?
No. We have a bar here, and the bar steward is only here when there's activities going on. So.
Okay, let's go down. We'll take a closer look.
We'll show you the running surface of the stone, of the curling stone. It's just this little ring that goes around. You can feel it. The stone is ground so that you have this, like it's a 3/8 of an inch wide ring. And that is what your stone runs on the ice.
Okay. So this is a flat part and the rest of it is curved.
It's curved, beveled. Now this stone weighs 44 pounds, as we mentioned before. It's all Scottish granite, blue granite.
Do they ever chip at all, Dan?
We have, in our 50 years, we've got one that's got a patch in it. Barry Vermont was able to put a patch in it for us.
Do you have any extra stones on hand?
No, because the stones are all ground differently, so that the eight here are a match set, and the eight red ones are a match set. So they react the same way.
So there's no room for error here. If something happens to a stone, you've lost half of your business here.
If something happens to a stone, what they usually do now is replace the two stones that the leader second played.
Okay, each stone is numbered, so this is the order that they throw them?
Yes. You'll see that each stone is numbered. The lead plays 1 and 2, the second plays 3 and 4, the third plays 5 and 6, and the skip plays number 7 and number 8.
Okay, you're able to grab these here because they've been thrown already.
Yeah.
And they're not within the scoring area.
They're not in play. They came behind the back line here. Once it comes across the back line, the stone is finished. Like this stone coming in is still in play because it's still in the house.
Now, I noticed you, when you told me the temperatures in here, you gave me Fahrenheit. Do you still talk in Fahrenheit?
Our thermometer is still in, well, that's a centigrade effect.
Yeah, Celsius up there, but
yeah.
But do you, that's
knowing
one thing
that you're Americans, I was talking Fahrenheit.
you converted it.
I am still of the Fahrenheit because centigrade only came in 12 years ago here now officially.
Yeah, it's very tough. I watch Channel 12 and Channel 6, and I hear them talking about the temperature, and I still got to try to figure out in my head when they say it's 6, exactly what they mean for...
Double it and add 30.
That gives you a rough idea.
Yeah.
It kind of rolls, it rumbles coming down the ice.
Yeah, you can hear the stone. That's because we have like 4 inches of styrofoam underneath so that it makes a funny noise, like that's the styrofoam insulation that we have underneath it that makes that noise.
All right, now I see some rubber pads here. This is the kickoff on here, this rubber that we see?
These are called the hacks, and you put, whether you're left-handed or right-handed, depending on which hack you use. We'll just get you a couple of brooms here.
You want to show us this lighter ball, or lighter stone?
This is the Kitty Rock stones. This is what the 8 to 10 years old start with. It reacts identical to the heavier stones, the granite stones.
What's it made out of?
This is a plastic. I'm not sure just what type of plastic it is.
What does a stone cost? Obviously, they can't be cheap. If you don't have extras on hand, it must be an expensive item.
Yes, a match set, which is 8 stones, will probably run you about $12,000 to $15,000.
Want to say that again, please?
A match set of 8 stones will run you, whether it's the blue granite or there is a cheaper granite in Scotland now that they're using, but it's between $12,000 to $16,000, $17,000.
Of course, that's Canadian dollars.
That's Canadian dollars.
It's only $12,000 if you're buying in American dollars.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money, Don.
That's a lot of money.
And you have four full sets here.
Yeah, you have to have two sets per sheet of ice.
So now, are there larger, like bowling alleys, you're going to have 8 lanes, you're going to have 16 lanes, you're going to have 30 lanes? Are there larger curling, what's it called, a curling arena?
Rink.
What is, rink?
The ones in Albany and Schenectady are 3-sheet clubs. Most of the country clubs around here are 2-sheet clubs. In Montreal, we have a 6-sheet club, Montreal, the town of Mount Royal, and we have a 4-sheet club at Dollard, Des Omeaux, Glenmore, and Montreal West. The rest are 3 or 2s. So out west, where curling is very avid, they have 8 and 12 sheet clubs. But one of the biggest clubs is in, I'm just trying to think, Minnesota. And they have a double decker. I think it's 8 and 8. 8 up top. And
wow, that's them Norwegians out there.
Yeah. But anyway, that's.
All right, let's get some brooms over here, Don, if we could. All right. All right, we've got some rubbers.
Okay, this is a slip-on gripper. Now, if you feel it, it's very soft rubber, and this will adhere to the ice, and you're able to walk on the ice. Now, this is the slip-on slider, and you'll feel this. This is very slippery. They call it in curling very fast. This is styrofoam. Neoplastic Teflon. And you slide this over your whatever you come with, a running shoe or something that's clean. And this gives you the ability to release your stone and slide out with your stone. Curling is popular because it's very little investment in equipment. Your gripper is around $8, and your slider, the slip-on slider, is about $12 to $15. But if you buy a pair of real curling shoes, you're looking at $70 to $100.
Now, wouldn't you want 2 grippers when you're out there sweeping?
No, 1 gripper and 1 slider.
Even when you're sweeping, not just when you're throwing?
Some people put 2 grippers on, but it's recommended that you have 1 gripper and 1 slider.
And you would, if you're right-handed, you'd go your right gripper be on your right foot, or?
Yeah, you slide on your left.
Okay, now we've got all right, we're going to watch this lady here slide out.
On her right foot, she has a gripper. She on her left. Well, this lady came down on her knee, and she's got a knee pad on. But usually, you let that leg trail behind you.
Well, she's now got her own style.
Yeah, everybody has their own style. Now, this is the other piece of equipment that usually you buy, is a brush or a synthetic.
Do you have brushes available here to rent?
Yeah, well, they're here. They're for anybody that wants one. Now, this is mostly all pig hair. These are all made out of pig hair. But the disadvantage of this type of brush is that one of these small hairs will come out and fall on the ice, and you can't see it, and it'll affect your stone and stop your stone immediately. So more and more they're going to the synthetic brush. They have the same effect, the same quality that you want of creating friction on the ice to make your stone stay straighter or go further, or not go further, maintain its momentum longer. So a brush, you're looking at $35. So for roughly $100, you've got all the equipment needed for curling. A sweater and a pair of gloves, because it's not too warm out here in the middle of winter.
And the sweater and pair of gloves you should own anyway, right?
Yeah.
Now, you you don't alternate when you throw your two stones. You
maintain
your consecutive, right?
Yeah. Once you establish your rotation, you keep that for the full game. There is nothing to say that when you come back and curl your second game, you cannot switch positions. But once you establish your rotation, you maintain it for the full game.
That's your batting order.
That's your batting.
All right. What's it? You mentioned the cost of equipment. What's it cost to if a team wanted to come down here and rent the ice? What's your cost?
To rent the ice, we do it first time. It's free. If you want to come, back, well, I'm not even sure. I think it's $50 an hour or something like that to rent the ice and use the equipment that's here.
So you could come with eight people.
Yeah.
And for $100, which is about $12.50 each, you could curl for 2 hours.
Yeah. But it's recommended that you get a little bit of instruction before you come out on the ice, because there's simple little things like people will have a tendency to pick a stone and pick it up. You never do that in curling, because if it falls on your toe, you've had it.
Well, plus you might crack your ice too.
Well, the ice, but the toe is muffled. I've seen it happen once, somebody drop a curling stone on their foot, and it's not a pretty sight.
Probably a little flatter than it was when they started, right?
Very.
Okay, we have moved inside out of the chill, the about 2 degrees below zero out there, Norbert.
Fahrenheit. What's centigrade.
And that translates to what, Fahrenheit?
About 29, something like that.
Very good. Norbert Yakey is joining us here, and Norbert's the reason we came down. Are you a curler now, Norbert?
Well, I've been curling for about 4 weeks. My in-laws have been trying to talk me into coming over here for quite a while, and I finally broke down, and I'm really enjoying myself. And I'd like to encourage anyone in the States that's watching this to come over here. It's $100 Canadian, which is figured out to about $68 American for the season. You can curl in regular men's leagues or ladies' leagues or mixed leagues or senior league.
Okay, give that price again.
It's $100 Canadian. I think that takes care of it all.
That's for seniors. Regular is $150.
Oh, okay.
So
I didn't know that.
For old people like Norbert.
Yeah, I'm a senior. There's no doubt about that. And I really find it a lot of fun. There's good fellowship here. It's a nice clubhouse. And it's just a nice place to come. And, you know, if you're going to be here all winter, or even most of the winter, it's, you know, you might as well be here as staying at home watching television.
And unless you're watching hometown cable.
Unless you're watching hometown cable. Of course.
Now, what, 4 miles? Roughly 4 miles from the border?
4 or 5 miles from the border, that's right. I think 6 miles from Champlain, to be exact.
So certainly no excuse. Sam's looking around the facilities here. There's a full-service bar. Has that place been seeing much business done?
No, the bar is what survives the club. And with only $150 membership, the bar is our lifeblood here. So, but the clubhouse here was redone. This section was redone about 7 years ago, and we're quite proud of it. It's got an upstairs to it for the kitchen. The changing rooms we used to have changing rooms that were just 8x10, and you get 8 people in the changing room 8x10, and that was pretty tight.
Especially when you got men and women together, Norbert.
Yes, especially when they get to be my size.
All right, Don gave you some pins here. I know you're
an old-time
pin collector.
You and your brother with these 50th anniversary pins.
All right.
And our thanks for coming over and giving some publicity to the club and showing people who might not understand curling, and I don't understand it either all the way, but I'm learning. And
well, my knowledge of curling has increased about 5,000-fold today. I still can't say I... Like
it really is an enjoyable sport, and it's, I think there's a fellow out there curling, this gentleman right here, who's 84 years old, you said?
Yeah, Wilson.
And he seems to be getting down and doing it just as well as anyone out there, so it's something that everyone can do. And it's very good exercise, as Don was saying earlier. I was surprised. I was a little sore the next day, the first time I tried it.
You use some muscles that you don't normally use.
You use some muscles, like sweeping. I'm not used to sweeping. My wife does most of that.
I've
very carefully cultivated the fact that I can't do anything like that around the house. I'm very inept, so she has to do it all.
But if she finds out that you've been here curling with that broom in your hand...
She wanted me to come up, too. And
maybe just so you could learn how to sweep.
Right,
maybe
so I could learn how to sweep, and gets me out of the house. And I'm here with all my in-laws, so I can't do anything bad, you see. So
they keep an eye on you. Huh?
They keep an eye on me, right.
All righty. Anything else, Don, that should cover while we're here?
Just a couple things. This on the wall over here, the girls from LaColle won the Dominion, were runners-up in the Dominion Finals in 50, you have to look at the pin, 58-59, I believe.
All right, which one are we looking at, right here?
Yeah, they're all...
1950 Dominion Diamond D Invitation Match. Oshawa? What's that?
Oshawa,
Ontario, March 25th, 1960. That's 1960, yep. That's 37 years ago.
Yeah.
We were both a lot younger then.
Yeah, that's for sure. But that was a team from LaColle that went to right through to the finals, of the Canadian finals. And over here, that banner on the wall, that's the... LaColle team won the province of Quebec here, 1995.
Just 3 years, 3 seasons ago. I assume that's...
Yeah, that's...
The winter months, March or whatever.
Yeah.
So would that be March? Would that kind of be when the season wraps up, April? When?
Well, this would be... The Canadian tournament would be held in the last of February because they had go to the Worlds after that. That team was... girls were all from LaColle, except for one of them that she was an import. But there's
a ringer? Is that
a ringer? Part? A ringer came in. But there's Kathy Derrick, Linda Kyle.
I guess there's no way of keeping track on a sheet of paper who your best players are individually, is there?
No. Curling is a team sport. It is... one of the sports that's unique because your captain up there, you have to have complete faith in his ability to decide what the ice is going to do. Curling is one sport where you have to work as a unit. You cannot be individuals out there. You have to work as a unit and to get along. And if you're going to some of these bonspiels, like leading up to this, it's a case of where you're living four people in a motel room for 3-4 days at a time, maybe 3-4 times in the month to make your qualifications to get out. So it's a case of where it's not the four best curlers of your club, it's four curlers that have the ability to get along and the ability to have complete faith in what the other one on your team is going to do. If they start yelling to sweep and you don't sweep, because you figure the stone is coming fast enough, you'd better be doggone sure what you're doing. But everybody's going to respect you for it, if you know what you're doing.
If you do it right.
If you do it right.
If you're wrong and they said sweep and you don't sweep, or vice versa, then you're in trouble.
Yeah.
Have you learned that yet, Norbert?
Yes, I do exactly what the skip tells me. I figure that's what they call the captain of the team. And I figure I can't go wrong if I do that. And as he said, it is a team sport, and I've always been in team sports and in individual sports too. And this really is a team sport. You must have faith in what that man does. You just can't go out and say, well, I can put this stone in there. No matter what he says, I know I can put it in there.
Well, you know you've got a good aim. You're a renowned pistol shooter, aren't
rifle
you?
Rifle shooter.
Rifle shooter, excuse me. Yeah. I know you're a shooter, but...
Yeah. Well... You know, hand-eye coordination, I suppose, helps, but this is a completely different sport. It's more like bowling, I would think, than anything else. The ball is always curving, and you're...
It's a stone.
The stone. Did I say ball? I'm sorry. And a stone. And as I've bowled all my life, I think it's more like that than anything else. So, but more of a team sport than regular bowling.
So are you part of a team here? You just come down and...
Yes, I am. Let's see, with my sister-in-law, Marge, and Marianne, who you know, and Johnny McCullum, who's related to the McCullums from Ross's Point, by the way, distantly.
I see there's a McCullum Road up here, too, up next to Noyan, too, I think.
Yeah.
On the McCullum Road?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So anyway, that's our team, and we haven't lost a point yet, and I credit that to my being the lead.
Well, it's got to be.
You haven't played against me yet either.
Oh. Is that happening soon?
Well, it will be.
Yeah, we'll be doing it, yeah.
Okay, once again, for anybody who was interested in being like Norbert and coming down here and learning about this, what would you invite them to do, Don?
I'd invite them to phone Norbert or phone myself at 514-246-3549, and we can organize the time and spend a couple hours here in the rink and introduce people to the roaring game of curling.
Okay, so that's an individual or a group?
You'll find my number in the Champlain phone book, and I'll be able to, I'd be glad to take down their name and let Donnie know when people would like to come up and curl. We'll arrange a time.
You'll find Norbert's phone number near the end of the phone book, in the
right,
Y's.
In the Y's, that's right. Only Johnny Zerlo's. After me.
Between the Zerlos and the Zawatskis All right, that's going to conclude our Hometown Cable's first look here at curling. And we've been at
the LaColle Curling Club. It's on Curling Street in LaColle from Champlain. You get in across the border at Champlain on Highway 221. You come to LaColle, you cross the railroad track, turn right, and we're down three buildings.
Now, that sign outside does not say LaColle Curling Club. It says?
Club de Curling.
Club de Curling LaColle. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.
Okay. I hope not everybody tuned away when we just signed off, but we do have a display case in back of Don. What's this stuff over here, Don?
This is equipment that you can buy. Like, these are curling gloves, the brushes, the shoes, grippers, sliders, what?
Kind of your pro shop here.
This is the pro shop.
And you have some pictures from the old time. And before I forget, this nice big sign here from my friend Fritz Kaiser. We went and did a nice story with Fritz a couple years ago and learned how to make cheese. Fritz sell cheese here?
Well, Fritz gave cheese to this Bonspiel we're running today. So that's some of the cheese upstairs we're eating. And he gave little gift packs for door prizes that we'll be drawing as soon as these teams are in off the ice.
So does Fritz curl?
Fritz doesn't curl, but he's a great supporter of the club.
Oh, that's a nice one. He's right there in Noyan. And some of the old pictures here, is this you in your younger days, or what's this?
Well, this is our original club, as I said before, was an army barracks, and you can get the idea of the very low ceilings. When you used to put your broom up, you'd hit the ceiling. But some of the people might remember the Maston family. This is a Mr. Maston, Jim Maston, that was one of the original founding members, and Margie Hope, his niece. Over here is a picture of the girls' team that was in 1960. We showed the plaque. This is a picture of the four girls that went to the finals of the Diamond D in Oshawa, the Canadian finals, and they lost. This is on...
Oh, before you leave that picture of those girls look a lot like women to me, Don.
Well, they're girls, women, whatever you want to say, I'm sorry.
Okay.
But I'm sure some people might know this is Lydia Hope, Margaret Dawson, Shirley Fuster, and Ruth Smith. All their husbands were in the Customs or Immigration in LaColle here for years. And on our next picture, I don't know if we can show it, but this was taken in the club here in, I would say, 53 or 54. But you'll notice the brooms that they're using, they're old kitchen brooms. And this is what curling all started with, and the building wasn't too solid. And the brooms were used sometimes to sweep the snow off the ice in front of your stones.
A couple people with names might be familiar. The man on the right is Mickey McGill, who was a custom officer. And then Chester Adams is the next man with the white hat. He is from Clarenceville.
Is his son the mayor there, Ken Adams?
No, I don't believe so. The other one is Bill Fuster, and the rest I haven't got a clue. This would be George Hope.
You recognize him from that angle?
Yeah, I recognize George fairly well from that angle. And this is what we call the founder of our club down here. This is Jim Hope. He was very instrumental in getting the curling club going in 47. He had a big backyard, and the first sheet of ice was outside in 1946 behind Hope's house, and they graduated to this building over the years.
All right, so he's the godfather here of curling in LaColle. And Bonspiel, does that translate into anything that we might be familiar with outside of the tournament?
Bonspiel is a curling terminology for tournament. It's strictly a Bonspiel from Scotland. Now, where Bonspiel came from in Scotland, I have no idea. But curling's tournaments are Bonspiels.
All right.
These people curling out here today, these are door prizes that will be offered to these people after they finish curling, and the winners come back on Wednesday. So, well, this is Fritz.
Oh, there we go.
This is the door prizes that Fritz gives for us. They do beautiful jobs of packaging their cheeses for us, and it makes a great door prize.
And they make excellent cheese. When we were up there doing our story, they gave us samples to take back, and they were all great. They do a nice job there.
Yeah, that's for sure.
All right, so that's, I think, going to finally wrap it up, and we'll say thanks again, Don, and maybe we'll be back again to cover some more of this.
Okay, thank you very, very much. And we'd like to get you out on the ice sometime.